Molt bona tarda. We're going to start the session on the New Deal on data, what role for cities. We have three incredible speakers today. We have José Luis de Vicente, who's the new Steve Graham, because Steve Graham couldn't make it at the last minute. So we found a really great substitute. José Luis is an independent curator. He's been involved in the Sónar+D, so working on technology, music, and also the role that display on in cities. We have Francesca Bria, the CTO of the city of Barcelona, so dealing with all the challenges that cities face when they want to do things well, when they want to put the citizen at the center of technological development. And we have Evgeny Morozov, a researcher and author of the Net Delusion and several articles that you've probably read, you're familiar with, that tend to shock us and awe us and make us think. The way we've designed the session is it's going to be an interactive session. So they'll have 5 minutes each at the beginning, and then I'll ask questions. You're also all encouraged to participate. We'll have a few minutes at the very end to take questions or reflections from the floor. I've been asked to tell you to use an application to send us the questions that you may have. I have tried to download the application to do that, and I think that the permissions that it asks are way too disproportionate. So you're free to use the application. I don't know why an application to ask questions at a Congress would want access to your contacts and your camera. So we're going to also take pictures from the floor. So you feel free to ask questions the old-fashioned way, the way that doesn't steal your data. And to kickstart the discussion, I think it's undeniable that data holds a lot of promise for cities. For a long time now, we've been hearing about how smart cities will help us make better decisions, build better infrastructure for cities, make better cities, empower the citizens. There's all these promise, all these expectations that we all have for data and technology in urban environments. But we've been building this relationship with technologies and in the city for a long time now. So we've also been able to see some of the less nice aspects of this relationship between the city and technology. We've seen how sometimes the use that we make of technology in cities can lock us in corporate silos. We've also seen how some economic actors tend to abuse the citizen and fall into the trap of data despotism. So they say they do everything for the people with the data of the people, but without the consent of the people, without ever asking the people what it is that you want me to do with your data or with the infrastructure that we're creating. We talk about empowering citizens, but maybe we're just promoting a new logic of accumulation that some have termed surveillance capitalism. We wanted to address all these issues with a specific focus on the city with the three speakers that we have today. So I won't say much more. I'll just leave the floor with them. So José Luis, they're all yours.
So thank you. Thank you, Gemma. I wanted to apologize to Stephen Graham followers because they're in for a disappointment. But I was happy to join this session because it was actually touching one topic around which I've worked for a good part of the last 10 years, actually, data and the relationship of data with citizens. Getting hold or like taking on the claim for the smart cities, poor cities for citizens, I was more interested actually to touching upon the relationship between citizens and data. And the data that citizens produce and what citizens can do with the data they produce and how the data that citizens produce is being put to use in different ways. Now that we're, it sort of feels like we're closing a historical cycle for different reasons. I like to think back to 2007, 2008, 8, 9 years ago, when we started to see the emergence of this new urban actor data in infrastructures that suddenly made not only data accessible, but made it visible in a different way, made it actionable. And that in that moment, citizens started feeling that they had a relationship to that thing. One interesting data-enabling infrastructure was, for instance, public bicycles, which I think that in this city was like the second in the world to get a public bicycle network that was producing data. And when they were introduced in Barcelona in 2007, that was a very interesting technology because it was a good example of here is a service that is only made possible by the use of data and how this data is actually allowing the systems to be managed and citizens to use the system because they're producing data attached to it. And at that moment, we were wondering, me and people working with data as a material that could be actionable and that citizens could own, what can we do with this? And we went to the people managing the system at that point. It was a company that had a concession, and the city council of that time had put it under that. And we asked them, do you know exactly who owns this data so that we can see what we can do with it? Because maybe this data is interesting for people to understand how they move throughout the city, for people to decide where do they want to locate all the stations. This can be like a vehicle for negotiation. And I will never forget that the answer to that question of who owns that data was, we don't understand the question. And it was really a different world. 1 year later, in 2008, with the start of the Obama administration, suddenly transparency, the open data revolution, and open data and public data by administrations became something that takes hold of public discourse in different ways. And we start a period where administrations, from municipalities to government, are expected to make their data available to citizens, let them use it, and even encourage them to do things with them, to innovate with them, with the notion that data produced by administrations in the hand of citizens was not only an act of transparency, but it was also a driver for innovation. And then we enter the age of the hackathon and civic apps and apps hackathons and thousands of experiments with hackers in log for 2 days in places sweating, trying to produce a prototype out of municipal data were produced in those years. If we look at the state of data produced by citizens today, once we can have a bit of historical distance, I think we can appreciate the enthusiasm and even a little bit the naivety of that moment. But the current paradigm is actually is much, much different. Citizens are producing incredible amounts of data about their actions in the world and actions in the city, but most of that data is locked into closed proprietary silos by companies who have encouraged them in many different ways to register and record their actions throughout the city, or in many cases, not even registering, just by the latent act of using those services, producing big amounts of data. A critical history of what came out of the data for citizens, open data movement, hackathon age, and what it contributed to democracy, to different forces of convenience in the city, is something that should be written. I think it hasn't been written today. I'm sure that Evgeny has a lot of points of view on that. But I think that we have lost the naivety of that moment. And actually, we are starting to be more concerned about what a new deal or what a civic pact around data could be or could mean like. Because the reality is that municipalities could do incredible things in terms of the knowledge produced by systems producing data based on citizens, but they have access to very, very little of that. And there is like huge silos of knowledge that are unlocked in places that you don't have access to. And the thing that I would personally worry me a little bit, and I think that now, 8 years later, it's kind of symbolic once the Obama administration is over and there's one a new one taking over, that a new pact around the relationship between cities, governments, and data should start to be established, because my concern would be that what we have in the producing is a form of dispossession, a form of taking value out of citizens by encouraging them to interact and put them in silos where this cannot be exploited. My concern would be that we have ended up basically creating Facebook for cities. And some people may think that that's a good paradigm. I personally feel that we can do better.
Thank you. Yeah. So, Francesca?
Well, thank you. Yeah, thank you, José Luis. Pleasure to be in this panel. First of all, let me just say that I wasn't there in 2008,
of course.
I wasn't the one responsible for the city information system, and so I don't want to get that kind of responsibility. Being serious, I think, you're posing some many interesting questions. I think we probably need to broaden up the framework in a sense that what we need maybe is a discussion that doesn't only look at data, or does it only look at what are the technological possibilities that we have. We probably need to frame this debate on what are the longer term choices that we're making in designing the future systems and institutions and future societies that we will be living in. So it's more for me a debate around rights, around democratic systems or systems of collective agreements or decision making. And then, of course, we have an entire question around power, I think. It is very clear to me, being also also in the position I am, that when we are talking about connectivity, artificial intelligence, ubiquitous data, these are the critical infrastructure of our future. I mean, these are the infrastructure that will underpin next generation public services, and I mean, we've been talking about it a lot in this space, that will determine how we're gonna manage public services, public infrastructures, energy, mobility, health, education. So basically, it will really affect specific choices that we are making about societal institutions, yeah? And of course, a part of that is technology. How can we design together technologies that have public return, that embed social goods, that take into account that we are designing together with citizens, that we should have, and I mean, I feel very much this, the responsibility to do this in a democratic way. I think in Barcelona, we are showing some examples of that. I mean, meaning that this is a government that has a mayor that comes from a citizen movement and a social movement, and that we are, everything we do and the policies that we're creating now in the city hall are designed together with the citizen as much as possible. There is a component on what kind of technologies we're using to do that, which is, I think, is addressed also in the Smart City Expo. Then there are lots of set of other issues, which is about what are the long-term choices in terms of the economic models and what are the long-term choices in terms of financing mechanisms that would allow, for instance, this kind of autonomy from a city's point of view to decide, you know, how you're gonna finance your public services or how you're gonna finance the technologies that are responsible, that have privacy and encryption for citizens baked into the technology, that are built in a way that are open source, that enable interoperability. I mean, all these kind of values, yeah, that you want to embed into the technologies. I think this is a matter of long-term choices, because also you need to make choices about the economic model, yeah? And that's where it becomes a little bit tricky for cities to be autonomous. So in that sense, I think we can do a lot of experimentation that is really helpful in defining what a new deal on data can look like, and maybe then we can say that cities can actually be an intermediary between, you know, the citizens. I mean, maybe even just for creating collective awareness about what are these rights to access and control and own data, and how we can make sure that we have an open data infrastructure in cities that is democratically managed, let's say. Then my other side, which I'm a bit more skeptical, that we do have that possibility to really determine these choices, is that I do see the concentration of power that also Gemma was mentioning. So, when I think what are the alternatives to, I mean, some have defined this kind of data ubiquitous model where there is no accountability as surveillance capitalism. I mean, it didn't only take Edward Snowden or the likes of Edward Snowden to arrive to such conclusion. And I don't think that only involve the role of government surveillance, but also an economic system that is based around aggregating, profiling citizens, continuously aggregating data in a way where the citizens don't really know, or maybe not all of them, what kind of data I'm giving away, who is accessing this data for what purpose, and what is the collective agreements around these transactions, meaning, you know, which is social agreements, which is about the economy and so on. And I think really the impact there, it could be that we have new models like the on-demand economy or the sharing economy platforms that are built on this possibility and these opportunities that data connectivity is giving to us, but that do not correspond to the way that we would like to maybe see management of transportation system or housing and so on. So we have problems that also pertains to respect of workers' rights, respect of some kind of local regulation about how you can rent your house, and that when you, how you rent your house doesn't have an incredible bad impact on the property market prices. I mean, what I want to say is that I think we should set some aspiration that the technologies that we use actually respond to the kind of policies we want to implement. So if we say, for instance, in Barcelona that our objective is to fight energy poverty, or if we say that we want to provide affordable housing or a better mobility system or better public health system, we are building the technologies that allow us to get there, to do that. And I think that that's where I would like to see more debate. So in Barcelona, just to end my first contribution, we're doing something that I think it goes in this direction. For instance, when we're talking about public procurement processes, that we are very careful to introduce clauses, ethical clauses, in the procurement process that allow public authorities to maintain a public ownership of data, and then to negotiate some forms of agreement with whatever the provider is. So this could be environmental impact, could be labor standards, gender issues, but also the question of governance over public information. And then again, I think it's really very important, and this is just an example because we have set out a plan which has in the title technological sovereignty, so clearly we are very concerned and very, very, very clear in saying that we would like to devolve power to the citizens and create a technological sovereignty for the citizens. So these are just examples, I think, of what can be done for this new deal on data. Now, what this how can we make this a reality? And clearly, we have to do it together. I mean, the cities are going to have to work with companies, with citizens, with, we have to create an awareness and start working out what the solutions are. And this is not an easy task.
Thank you so much. Evgeny.
Sure. So what is the New Deal on data, right? I mean, if you try to understand the genealogy of this term, sooner or later, we'll probably stumble upon someone like Sandy Pentland at MIT, who's been pushing this idea of the New Deal of Data in Davos and a few other places. But the idea is actually pretty tame. It rests on the assumption that we, the users, generate a lot of data. That data ends up in the silos and on the platforms that you have heard about, and that we need to find ways, legal and technological, in order to bring that data back to us, the users, so that we can monetize it, but also so that we can maybe innovate with it, right? And I actually think, in as much as this idea got a lot of traction in the business world and the political world, it actually doesn't do justice to the model that it was inspired by, namely that of the New Deal. I mean, what was the original New Deal? The original New Deal, as those of you who are familiar with history would know, it was actually a compromise struck in the 1930s in the United States following an immense economic crisis, not unlike the one we are living through right now. It was a deal between essentially big business and governments, right? And the agreement was that big business will more or less agree to certain concessions. The government would push for certain reforms when it comes to public provision of infrastructure, when it comes to certain basic institutions of the welfare state, and there would be some compromises, but there would also be quite a lot of sacrifices. And that would help the current system, which of course was capitalism, survive the threat that was coming at the time from fascism on the one hand and communism on the other. I actually think that the times that we're living through right now are not that different from 1930s. There is an economic crisis that's quite severe. We're seeing its consequences and outcomes wherever the leaders that we have there to still hold elections. And that in itself creates a rather difficult situation because people are searching for answers, right? Why their lives are not getting better but actually getting worse. I think there is a very direct link to the rise of the digital economy, and that there is a very specific role that the rise of technology and information heavy firms has played in creating the immense level of inequality that we currently have, I mean, look at the 5-6 largest firms by cash reserves, by market capitalization. Virtually all of them are technology firms, which was not the case 20 years ago. They concentrate huge amounts of capital. They employ very few people. That situation is only going to get worse. Right? The people, of course, and the public still are searching for different kinds of explanations. They are not looking at the technology sector. They are not looking at the role of data. They are not looking at the role of information. They are looking for other scapegoats. They are looking at immigration. They are looking at race, gender, and so forth. Right? Sooner or later, this giant myth-making enterprise that has arisen around the world of technology, partly through conferences and festivals, we should not be coy about that, is going to fall apart. People will see where the value originates in the digital economy, that it's intricately linked to the production of data, that the entire digital economy rests on what I would call data extractivism, that data extractivism that leads and feeds into creation of advanced artificial intelligence services, which sooner or later will actually rob us of the last jobs that actually still exist, and that will create major social unrest. I don't think that we can continue misleading people for far too long. Sooner or later, that will become obvious. The moment it becomes obvious, I argue, people will start seeing the industry that heavily relies on data, that extracts that data, monetizes it, and then keeps all the rents to itself. They will start seeing it as an enemy that is not just akin to Wall Street and the financiers, but perhaps even worse, because the effects of it will actually be greater, because the consequences of it will be felt not just in some abstract financial world, it will also be felt in the everyday life as data is extracted from essentially corners of everyday living. That said, I think, yes, it is time to strike a new deal on data if we do not want to see one of the two alternatives, right? And I've argued what those were, and they're still the same as they were in the 1930s. Me being kind of on the radical end of the spectrum, I actually wouldn't mind that deal on data not to be reached, assuming that we do want to somehow still recreate some capitalism with a human face. I think it is essential that we do start tracing where the value in the digital economy comes from. Then we have to understand how some of that value can actually be passed on to the citizens. We have to also realize how some of the actual organizational and institutional opportunities that are created around data can actually be given away to citizens so they can start organizing their own life with the help of those technologies and platforms outside of the institutions of corporations and the state. I don't think that another future is actually will be desirable by these people. What this means in practice is that, A, we do need an alternative legal regime for how to own and treat data. We have to understand that we will not be able to resolve this question just by treating it as private property and just saying that, you know, you own the data that you generate, or treating it as something that's not property altogether. I mean, if you look at how Google and Facebook treat data, they don't treat it as private property. They basically tell us, well, we take your data because we offer you services. Don't even think about property relations. Right? I don't think that either of those two solutions actually is going to work. I think the first one about treating it as basically private property is not going to work because ultimately the value of my data does not just derive from what I can do with it, it derives from how much other data I have and how much computing infrastructure and computing resources I actually have at my disposal to make any sense of it and to process it. And clearly, if I lack access to advanced computing infrastructure, if I lack access to other types of data, the value of my own data to me is very small. It's much smaller to me than it is to a company like Google or IBM. Right? So it's obvious that we need to start looking for other solutions where we can actually maybe pull the data of citizens together, find ways to actually recreate some of the computing infrastructure through which we can actually analyze some of the data. But all of that has to be done in a somewhat more collective social manner than it has been done so far. I mean, some cities, I would argue, those who actually understand the severity of the economic and political danger facing us today might actually be very good mediums and vehicles for enacting some of that program. I don't think that all cities have realized it. I think a lot of cities are actually actively pushing away from the danger that's facing them. Nonetheless, I do think that those cities that would like to rethink and maybe avoid a lot of embarrassing moments where, you know, their citizens will be realizing sooner or later who actually stands to benefit from digitization and who is there to reap all the rents from digitization and who is there to actually become quite rich at their expense because it's their data that's being extracted, converted into AI, and then being sold to the citizens themselves as a service. I do think that those cities that would like to avoid that embarrassment should start thinking actively and aggressively about creating the right kinds of infrastructures and the right kinds of legal regimes to actually allow citizens to exercise the technological sovereignty, to exercise the data sovereignty, and to basically to find ways of profiting from the immense capabilities and capacities of technological infrastructure around them to pursue their life projects as they see fit. Right now, if you do want to pursue a life project as you see fit, you are faced with nothing but a choice of service providers. And that's the reality of today. Those services are not free, regardless of what this pseudo-welfareism of Silicon Valley tells us, that they can offer us everything for free. The only reason why they can offer us everything for free is because they also extract data in the process, which then they use to train their advanced artificial intelligence to then come and steal our job. So, I mean, I don't buy the argument that it's offered to us for free. It isn't. Right? And I think, I mean, you cannot be kind of hiding this reality from people for far too long. I think the troubling signs we've seen this year have indicated to quite a lot of people that something is not working in the global economy. I think sooner or later they will realize where all the cash goes. They'll realize it goes to tech firms, and that's the reality I've already outlined. So I think I will actually stop here. I know it's a very macro global level picture, but I think without seeing that macro global level picture, the discussions about the New Deal on data would not lead us very far. Because ultimately, there has to be a vision not just for the cities, there has to be a vision for states, there has to be a vision for regions and regional bodies like the European Union, the European Commission in this case. If that vision is missing, all we'll end up with is just accelerating the already rather destructive, tragic process of data extractivism that I have outlined. Thank you.
Thank you. So just to take it a bit further from Evgeny's last words, we've been changing scale all the time. We've been talking about global corporations, then the city, then a New Deal program, which was a national program with a regional impact. So what role can cities play? Because one thing is pretty obvious. At the city level, you can see when the relationship between society and technology is broken. And we have a perfect example in Barcelona. About 3 years ago, 4 years ago maybe, there was a plan to develop a fab lab in a poor neighborhood in Barcelona. And the neighbors stormed the building because they wanted a food bank. They did not want a fab lab, they wanted a food bank. So there's something fundamentally broken in the relationship between technology, society, and policymakers. And at the city level, you feel that, because it's when you see what citizens want from you. But can cities react to that at the age of global capital, when technological companies are beginning to seem like too big to fail? Can cities change anything, or are we just fooling ourselves, like Evgeny seems to imply?
No, that's not what I imply. Let me just clarify. This is not what I'm implying. I mean, you cannot afford not to be present at the city level because the city right now is the site of accumulation and data extractivism, partly through the program of the smart city. This is where data is being extracted. Whether you want it or not, if you actually want to solve the problem of data extractivism, you have to be at the city level. Then, of course, you can ask a lot of questions, how to link it to national, global, regional, transnational, transplanetary level. All of that is up for grabs. I just don't think they can afford to ignore what's actually happening, and it is happening at the city level. So I'm not in any way denigrating that scale.
So yeah. Francesca, do you think you can do something?
First of all, let me say that, Evgeny is very good in depicting this kind of tragic stories where everything is falling apart and, we have ground zero, and maybe correctly so. I don't want to contest the big picture. I think that in relation to what he describes as data extractivism and this financialization, extreme financialization of data, which also corresponds to a financialization of the models on which we are supposed to fund public services, for instance, or to fund basic infrastructures, or to fund the welfare state. I mean, at that level, which I think it's a conversation of macroeconomics that doesn't only, of course, involve cities, I think that there is a lot of discontent. I think I think that the discontent has been expressed, I mean, by nation states that don't want to really adhere to severe austerity policies, or, I mean, globally, just the financial crisis is a reality. And, I mean, debt financing is not the best way to fund robust infrastructure that should serve everyone. I mean, if we are talking about inclusive infrastructure or inclusive public services, then of course we do have a problem. I mean, and we do have a problem at city level, because I mean, many cities have debts where they cannot afford to actually fund these things in a different way. So so at that level, the system is broken. But I would argue that maybe we have a broader alliance of people that, a broader alliance, which also means alliance of cities, but also with nation states and communities and citizens, which actually, basically are left out of a system that is functioning only for the few. So this is a problem. And I think this is a problem also for visions like the smart city, because if you cannot show that this works not only in the core of man, like the core of the most advanced economies, in the even in the most kind of rich cities, if you cannot show that this is a model that can work at a planetary level, I mean, the smart city here, there were a lot of countries from the global south, which clearly have problems also, like in basic infrastructure level of sanitation and transport and healthcare system and so on. I mean, if this is really broken, this is not a very appealing vision. I mean, it's not. You are not going to get anyone buying into this vision anymore. I do think that also we have a broader alliance of in the company space, which I think, for instance, the model of Silicon Valley kind of the first gets it all, like this kind of lock-in model, the monopolistic approach to the digital economy. I mean, I think a lot of companies in Europe actually are contesting that model. I mean, and starting from a very basic fact that the European economy has a lot of SMEs, very small businesses, that actually our productive economy and the future economy, which, I mean, now we talk a lot about getting manufacturing back home, being very careful about the impact on jobs and all these kind of things. I mean, we have an economy made by small companies that really are left outside, no? And I mean, here, for instance, even at city level, we are trying to show that we can do much more to involve smaller companies, that we can make sure that the digital economy and even data can be a basis for a more inclusive economy, an economy that's not based on commodification and financialization of data, but also serves to develop a more collaborative economy with some kind of models that have an impact on the environment, which is good, that can... And I think also on labor, I have to say, some of these visions where, you will have extreme automation, and that's it, and that 60% of the jobs we have now will disappear. I think we need a debate on that. I mean, meaning that a lot of policymakers actually are designing a digital agenda saying it's going to have a huge impact on work, and we're going to provide good jobs and better jobs, and this is not the case at the moment. And I mean, and clearly the example like Uber, which is now the reference of what it means to have a really precarization of labor, I mean, where even the employees are not called employees, they're called contractors. And all the responsibilities are in the shoulders of the individual, and that a lot of the labor rights and standards that we actually achieved throughout times are completely abandoned. I think this is not a sustainable model. So, yeah. So, I mean, what is left there for cities? Is that the question? What I just want to say is that, as everything else, when you have complex problems and things that you need to work at different layer. So cities are never completely independent from whatever nation states decide or the regional or the global economy. I mean, we live in a super globalized economy. I think when it's very clear for me, the stuff that Evgeny criticizes, when we're talking about the impact on data, now you have to look at trade treaties. I mean, like TTIP and TPP, I mean, TISA, they have actually a big part, which is about free flow of data. where a lot of these questions around citizens' rights and around how you can make sure that, for instance, we have a data protection regulation in the European Commission and this is implemented, it's going to be very difficult. And I mean, that's where the technological sovereignty vision, which is, okay, we are building data sovereignty and technological sovereignty for our citizens, mean that you can also make sure that data protection regulation in Europe is implemented. So maybe we have to look at different schemes and different way to do that. I don't think that cities can do that, this alone. I mean, it's absolutely out of the out of question. But then what can cities do is, you know, orchestrate better systems, you know, making sure that specific regulations are in place and that we create a level playing field so that we don't get this kind of lock-in predatory platforms or predatory approach, but we make it more open. And we have very, very clear citizen rights at the core of what we do.
But listening to you, it seems like we've created a field in which the winner takes all. So it's only a handful of operators that benefit from this system. So cities lose, SMEs lose, citizens lose. Isn't it surprising that there isn't more of a push for reclaiming the data infrastructure?
You know, in Germany, they have this word, I really like this scheme they use, which is information self-determination, right? And I mean, like actually the other day, Angela Merkel, which is, I mean, is one of the most important leaders we have in Europe right now, she was advocating for our algorithmic transparency of those platforms. I mean, she actually said it in a meeting, she said it very clearly, we have to start demanding platforms. I mean, as you know, the European Commission is doing things like antitrust, you know, there is a lot of actions that are happening at a very different level, but she's saying we should demand algorithmic transparency because if I cannot inspect the algorithm, and if I don't know what's happening, I cannot regulate because I don't have any, I don't know how this affects the pricing, I don't know how this affects the information self-determination of citizens, all of that. So I think, I mean, actually on this more aligned with Evgeny, I think there will be a pushback. I mean, maybe we see some pushbacks at the moment. I don't think it will come only from cities or for citizens. I think it will come also from other companies that they see that there is no space for them. I don't think that here we're envisioning a world where Google is going to run everything, healthcare, transportation, mobility, like everything is going to be run by Google. I mean, no, I think there is going to be more plurality and there's going to be a space for much more many players.
Well, one thing that I wanted to wonder a bit about aloud is how you disalign the interests of cities and the interests of citizens, because actually the notion that what is good for cities is good for citizens, and then what administrations do is the best they can do in the interest of every citizen is just not true. And this is why we're sitting in a lot of conflicts, you know? The citizens facing the sharing economy are completely disaligned in terms of who are the winners and who are the losers. So I think we're getting to a point where for city administrators, for city for people in city departments running contracts, contracting services that produce data, at this point in 2016, they have no excuse for not understanding what is the implications of the access, ownership, transparency regimes of the data that they produce. But the problem is with those services that basically will just align so well with the interests of specific groups of citizens, that how do you operate with them so that they don't impact the common good of the whole group of citizens? And in many cases, actually, data is kind of being a tool to understand to what extent they are protecting the interests of that specific set of users. We have home sharing, big services protecting the data that they store that would actually be the one that tests and actually proves the real actual impact that they have on a major scale on the city and then on every citizen. So the disalignment is actually a bit harder, and I think we're going to end up, I almost hate this idea, but I don't have any word for it, developing more like a slow data approach to the personal use of services and what is the impact in our community, in the communities that we belong to.
Okay, hold your thoughts because we have three questions from anonymous people.
Great.
I'm very happy about that. But if we have questions from the floor as well, we don't have much time, so I suggest we take them all at once. Do you mind if we do that? And then we give you a couple of minutes each to get back to them. So if you have any questions, please go to the microphones. I'm going to read the ones that I have here in the meantime. So one person asks, are there examples of oversight mechanisms to prevent politicization of data or its subversion by special interest groups? And one that is related to this one, what is the alternative to big tech firms? And the third question is, who should control citizens' data? Are citizens' data vaults a viable solution to avoid silos? Should that way vault keepers and citizens profit out of it? So these are the three questions that I have here. I see one person on the mic, so please go ahead. Make it short, please.
Hello. Yeah, I just want to share this thought about what if city councils and public administrations were to include in their public procurement process an ethical clause that forces big companies to publish data on an open data format whenever they collect more than, let's say, from 1,000 users.
Mm-hmm. And?
Yeah, hi. Yes. So I want to ask about the question of intelligence and where it's located and centralized, because the one intelligent insight that could have massive transformative effects is that data is much easier to distribute than energy. With energy, the physics of it is you lose a lot of it as you distribute it more and more. And we've built our server farms in a way that we centralize the data in these massive server farms, propped up by the contracts and other kind of economic ways to obscure the physics, that then we distribute the energy to power centralized data, as opposed to taking the data into hybrid energy sources, which have been specifically disincentivized and made illegal by cities and states so that they protect the interests of existing monopolies of energy utilities, right? So we have this, we have on our side the intelligent deep learning, the capacity that I would say that cities also have on their side, that they may not necessarily be invested in protecting the existing corporate centralized or the centralization of anything and the centralization of power, but that we have the capacity to, through the messy, deliberative, democracy, debate-oriented, you know, ideas, marketplace of ideas, that we can actually challenge how we do our infrastructure. And I think it's not so much the data that's at stake, it's the food that you suggested, it's the energy systems, it's the basic water treatment that is currently also being done in an incredibly insane, centralized manner, which could be better done at a different scale just because of network physics. So our capacity to reinvent how we use data and what we use it for, I would argue, could be located not in Google and not in their protectionist contracts and other strategies to centralize the profit. Distributed systems promote local ownership, local management, local interpretation. And the very challenge is that centralizing data and artificial intelligence may not turn out to be intelligent at all.
Thank you. I think most of these questions would deserve a session on their own.
We have lots of lights coming in.
I don't think there's anyone else at the mic, so I'm going to have to be very mean and ask you to get back to them in a couple of minutes
maybe
each,
I can
or do what
this,
you can.
This last one, and you can take the rest. I mean, we need some kind of hybrid approach when it comes to architectures and infrastructures. For instance, today we spent the entire, you were there, Gemma, as well. I mean, we spent a lot, a few hours,
yes,
in a workshop where the European Commission is putting out a call on next generation internet, where they're specifically asking to come out with alternatives that imply distributed architectures, systems that allow citizens to govern data, to own data, and that are privacy protecting, and all these kind of things. And this is just at a technology level, but implying that this kind of technology layer will be integrated with different types of infrastructure when it comes to energy and food and that kind of things. So I think there is a need and a will to experiment on this kind of distributed systems, and then even on collective contracts or collective agreements that set what kind of terms for access and governance of these shared resources we can put in place, and so to experiment with new models. I think there is a need for this, and it's recognized. I mean, at least we have a space even at a European Commission level, which is I'm very pleased to acknowledge that. Yeah.
Well, since we're out of time, I'll be very brief, and I'll try to give an answer that will satisfy some, not others, but it'll be a very macro-level answer. So, you know, for me, the question really is, what can cities do in all of this, right? And I think if you think about how digital capitalism, if you want to call it digital, operates, mostly it operates by obfuscation, right? It operates mostly by spreading a lot of confusion about its actual functions and its actual distribution processes. And I think cities are actually key to that process of obfuscation, right? And how are they key? They key to it by spreading three narratives. One is about technology, the power of Uber, Airbnb, the power of Google to resolve all of our problems, save money, and so forth. You know, so this is the way out of the crisis. Save money, put sensors everywhere, life is gonna get better. Number two is finance. You know, financialize everything, infrastructure, get debt, you know, finance everything through tolls, get social bonds, pay for outcomes. You know all the story very well. It's basically creating a myth around the power of finance. And the third pillar is about the power of cities themselves, which I think is a narrative that just has to be blown apart. Cities have to basically step forward and say, our hands are being constantly constrained by trade treaties, by privatization, by the actual local laws coming from federal and municipal and regional level. They basically prohibit us from solving our own problems in the way that we would like, while the discourse around cities constantly expects us to rule the world and solve all of the world's problems, because cities is not where we get things done. Cities have to oppose that discourse. They have to say that, no, we cannot solve a problem like Airbnb, because Airbnb at this point in many countries functions as an alternative to the welfare state by giving people a chance to earn some money in an economy that no longer functions. And actually, governments have done their best to promote that through their promotion of the ideology of home ownership. This is a problem that exists at the national level, which cities cannot solve. So if they go and frontally attack Airbnb and bang their head against the wall, they're actually gonna lose their own voters. Which doesn't mean that cities shouldn't be critical about these problems, but they should really deflate this bubble that has more or less emerged around cities. Cities cannot solve those problems. They should be actually critical in punching this myth that exists about the ability of digital capitalism to adapt and get out of the crisis. And I think this is the best thing that cities can do. You know, organize festivals, organize critical events, organize the kind of discourse that can actually puncture this bubble, because once this bubble bursts, there will be a lot of blood. I'm sorry.
Okay.
Can I be the optimist?
Yes.
Can I be the optimist?
Please.
Okay, I'll try to be the optimist. No, but actually building on Evgeny's argument that cities' hands are tied, so stop with the bullshit that cities will change the world. No, there's actually, I think, a bigger problem here, which the New Deal of cities would be part of, which is the notion of to what extent can you do a different innovation policy? I mean, are your hands tied to do a different innovation policy? Because we ended up actually in a paradigm of how technology will help to rethink cities that is very much copy-pasted everywhere, you know? And what we find when you introduce a different set of parameters is resistance. And it's resistance on different levels, whether it's if you introduce a social currency as an experiment, or you take off traffic from a set of blocks and then try to create another way of cohabitants, or you try to create cities and run infrastructures that will replace big telecommunications. Now, I consider that actually these things are pretty good news, because it means that at least finally we can contest different models of innovation, and actually that there can be a fight that is going to be political and ideological and practical on the models of innovation policies that we can apply at city level. And I think this is a conversation that very likely we were not having 5 years ago, and that's at least a minor, maybe temporary, improvement or advancement in terms of what do we take for granted or not. Also, some of the crises that are being produced by the copy-paste model of innovation policy are blowing up in our faces and are changing the lives of citizens in ways that are being traumatic. So this conversation is here with a new deal or data or not, and we will have to face it and embrace it in the coming years.
Thank you. I think it's quite obvious that we're living in an amazing time to rethink the relationship between technology, society, yeah. and data, because we are seeing how there's, yes, good things, but also some risks out there that need to be tackled. So I hope that the panel today has helped you think about things differently and hopefully act and be at the forefront of exposing the things that are happening that we don't like and promoting the things that we would like to see happening technologically so that our cities do become better places to live and for their citizens. Thank you all for coming and see you around.